So, just for context, everybody, these guys host a really successful podcast called Group Chat.
That we make no money on.
Nothing yet. Yeah.
But it is number one.
All marketing.
Gotta build the audience, yeah. And then you monetize. These guys are successful entrepreneurs, investors, operators. They all have lots of opinions, number of varied interests. Their program, their podcast covers basically everything from business to culture to current events, politics, whatever they're really in the mood to talk about. The other thing is that we're all, I think, LPs in Queensbridge Venture Partners, yep. Right? And so anybody who's attended Acceleration in the past has met Nas and Anthony and AJ. Queensbridge Venture Partners, for everybody who doesn't know, we're invested in Casper, Robinhood, Lyft, Dropbox, Thrive Market. What else am I missing?
Ring, PillPack.
Yep. Bunch of billion-dollar exits over the past year or so. So these guys are fresh off the boat from Coachella, we're gonna jump into it. I think just to be able to set the stage, I guess give everybody the lay of the land. Like how did two Indian dudes from LA link up with the white guy from Ohio?
So our story started 17 years ago. I started a brand called 5-4, men's fashion brand, and about 7 years into that business, during the recession, we really started struggling. So we're looking for all these different opportunities. And a friend of mine at the time called me and said, I'm working on a new television show, and one of the stars of the show is looking to start a clothing line. And I was 27 or 28 at the time, wasn't watching MTV, and he turned me on to a show called Fantasy Factory. And Drama wants to be called Chris because supposedly everyone's smart and sophisticated.
Yeah.
But his name's Drama. And they had a hit television show on MTV called Fantasy Factory. And it was the first time that we were given an opportunity to fully integrate a brand onto a television show. And he had control of it. So I was like, let's give this a shot. And he introduced me, his former manager introduced me to him. And we integrated Young and Reckless into the show and launched it in 3,000 retailers. 6 months later, it was on television, and then the next day it was in every mall in America, and the brand just took off, and that brand's called Young and Reckless. And so we've had that brand now for 10 years, and now we're trying to become famous. Oh, well, he's actually famous. I'm recently started trying.
Yeah. So my keynote was obviously about customer experience, and I tested some of the material out on Twitter a few days ago, and Dee responds instantly and was like, yeah, that's why I decided to become famous. And I know like you guys saw the trend in terms of like trying to break the addiction to like Facebook ads and relying on kind of more traditional customer acquisition tactics. Talk to the audience about that path where like you started to realize maybe diminishing returns and what the thought process was on kind of how and why you would need to diversify.
Yeah, so I'll give you the background for our group of brands, and then Drama can give Young and Reckless. So we became one of the largest men's fashion subscription boxes. It's now called Menlo Club. And we launched that in 2012, and in 2014, we had never advertised on the internet. We started advertising on Facebook, and then eventually Instagram. But we started spending $100 a day in January of 2014. I think by like 90 days later, we were spending $10,000 a day. And a year later, we were spending $30,000 a day. Then it went to $50,000 a day. Customers were flying in, 1,000 customers a day, and our customer acquisition cost was so low that we never had any venture funding. We had a small family office give us money 12 years ago. So we scaled this business quite large, very easily. And then 2 years ago, one day our customer acquisition cost just exploded. It went from like, it was very low, to quadrupled in 90 days. And we didn't have the cash to sustain to do that. So I started cutting our spend and I said, let's try, I think you touched on it, you try all these different ways to shift your budget. So we did television, we did podcasts, influencers. We have a ton of A-list celebrities wearing our product. And finally, after like a year of just like tried everything and kind of gave up and said, we're just going to cut the spend and need to figure something else out. And what I realized in that whole process was we weren't connecting with customers. We were just a growth hack. We were just really good at acquiring customers on Facebook and Instagram, but we had no relationship with our customer. So I was like, how can I change that? How can I actually build a relationship? And I'm actually not joking about being famous, but I literally walked into the office and told my staff one day, I'm gonna become the face of the brand and I'm gonna connect with our customers. Because the week before we did an event with Chris Paul, who's one of our brand ambassadors, basketball player, and we had a nice turnout. The week later I did a meetup and I had more people come to meet me. And what I realized is in today's market, people wanna know who the CEO of a business is. They want transparency of how you run the business, why you do it. And more importantly, I'm more of a relatable figure. Like, I'm as average as come from like background and to just about hard work and perseverance to be why I'm in the position I'm in today. So my customer was like, ultimately, I'm their big brother. I'm 38 years old. I'm married with a small child. And that allowed me to connect with more people than a basketball player who has a God-given talent that none of us have. So when we went on that journey, we were trying to figure out, like, how do you actually do that? And so that's when Drama was like, you need transparency in who the leader of the company is. Because today, if you don't know the CEO of the company for a younger customer, I don't think they're buying that product or that brand.
Yeah. Yeah, for me, I think I learned the lesson really early, right? Because we launched my brand off of a reality television show. And the cool thing about it was, it wasn't just me wearing it on the show. It wasn't surface level. You actually saw me start the brand and build the brand, and we made episodes about it. We made an episode where I had to jump out of a six-story building, and the sixth story had a sign that said Young and Reckless, and the fifth story said Young and Risky, and the third story said Young and Regular, and whatever one I jumped out of was the name of the brand, right? And so it was really integrated in a way that I think young people saw. They felt like they were seeing a brand get built. They felt like they were seeing someone come from being a personal assistant to being an entrepreneur, and that really connected. So we had success pretty early because of that connection. So obviously for us, as they were growing with the Facebook and Instagram ads, we started needing to figure out new ways to grow, new audience, and obviously switching to e-com. So we took a lot of notes from what they were doing and started also doing ads and stuff like that ourselves. But what I've noticed, at least for us, is you see a lot of brands that growth hack and then they hit a wall and there's just nowhere to go from there, and that's kind of a big problem that keeps repeating itself. In my mind, I think you really need to ask how you're creating a brand through content or how you're creating a connection with something sustainable through content, and then being able to re-serve those people ads so that you make sure that when you have a new product, they see it. And that's what we've been able to really do. Our ads now, I mean, we have a lot of, you know, ads that say new denim, you know, $39.99 and kind of the go-to ads, but we also have a lot of ads where I'm still in that character from our TV show days, walking through our warehouse with confetti and saying, new product available now, and look at, you know, this and that, and there's craziness flying all over the place. And so I think that even while we're spending, you're still gaining brand and still gaining connection. The problem is it's harder to tally up where it's going, right? Because your return on that spend isn't going to be the same as if you put jeans for next to free, right? Of course, that's going to have a higher return than this thing. But long term, I think you have to stick to that. And I think that builds something that you can really scale and you're not going to gas out. The last thing is, the funny thing is, last night I walked to Walgreens to grab some stuff for, grab some toothpaste and stuff. And the guy at the counter said, hey man, are you Drama by chance? And I said, yeah man, that's me. He said, yeah, you know, I used to watch Fantasy Factory when I was young, but lately I've just been getting served all your ads lately and they're so funny.
Yeah.
You know, that one you did in the whatever costume was so good. And it's like, man, like the updated version of being recognized from a reality show is being recognized for creative, funny, entertaining Instagram ads. And I thought that event last night really sort of woke me up to like, man, I need to put way more effort into these things. And I need to do that way more, because that's what he's grabbing onto, not, man, your jeans are a great price. So I think that was kind of my view of it.
I just want to add one thing, that most of the D2C companies right now are, their customer acquisition is just subsidized by venture capital money. And that is going to run out, because if you look at everyone's financials for all these D2C companies, everyone's profitable 2 years from now. No one's actually profitable now. The math doesn't work, so we have to change the script.
Right. And I love what you guys talked about in terms of creating the content and owning the conversation and being transparent. Like, I think to me it kind of all just boils down to like authenticity, right? If you can create that connection. And so, Drama, you kicked off the podcast thing with Short Story Long.
Yep.
And you've been doing that now for a few years.
Yep.
So I would say like you saw it pretty early.
Yep.
What kind of gave you that inclination? Was it all the stuff we talked about, or was there like a defining moment where you're like, hey, this is, because it wasn't obvious back then.
No, it wasn't, but I think it was kind of a couple things lining up. I think that I realized early, like I said, the power of content and connection and constantly having some sort of relationship with your fans or your audience that's entertaining and that actually gives them some value. And I think that I saw podcasting bubbling up. I had done years and years of television where you have to show up at a certain time every day and there's this big crew and everything's so kind of by the book. And what I loved about podcasting is I could start in my office with two microphones and it could be crappy and I could figure it out. I mean, I wasn't an interviewer and I didn't realize how hard it actually was. Mm-hmm. But this allowed me to start rough and just try it, and I could put it out at any time. It was on my own schedule, all that stuff. So I think that's what really drew me to it. And I think, you know, I just had to kind of dig deep and say, well, at the end of the day, what is our brand about? My brand's called Young and Reckless, and I really want it to be a more positive message, right? It's about breaking out of, you know, the plan that maybe your parents have for you or your local town has for you and living the best life you can. So I interview self-made, really successful, or really successful in any area of life people, from CEOs to athletes to whatever. And I just jumped into it. And I think that rawness and that ability to market it yourself and do all that yourself really drew me to it. And it started really rough because the fact that there is so many podcasts and there's no big platform to kind of launch you like MTV, it started really rough and really disheartening, but it caught on and it really became something way greater than what I originally planned.
Yeah, that's a great segue. So Spotify is one of our big customers. Seems like they're trying to put together potentially like the MTV for podcasts. Like why do you think now is the time for podcasts and kind of this audio revolution?
I think the biggest opportunity is that like every company needs a voice. I think and there's a listener out there for everyone. And I think people don't have the confidence to think, like, I'm a confident person, so like I went out there and said, I think people want to hear what I have to say. But I find everyone I meet interesting. And I think podcasts allow a very simple way to communicate with people. And even if it's only 50 people that listen and pay attention to what you're doing, it is a very powerful medium, because people who listen to our podcast, we have their attention for 3 hours a week.
Yeah.
That's an insane amount of time and mind share we have. And podcast is the one medium. For some reason, there's a deeper connection with podcasters and their audience than any other thing that we've ever done. And I mean, he was on a very large television show at the peak of MTV. And he would even argue that like the connection we have with our group chat listener today, it's nuts. Like, it's such a, they know everything about our life. And we're also, the opportunity is also to be transparent, not just show your perfect life.
Yeah.
Like, if I end up blackout drunk, I talk about it. And like, it's like, you have to be vulnerable. And podcasts, if you're vulnerable
right.
and you actually share your real life, I think there's such a big opportunity that like, we see a world where like every company is doing podcasts, everybody is podcasting, mm-hmm. For whoever the audience that wants to connect with you. And I think the customer today has the choice. You don't all watch the same thing anymore.
Yeah. I was on a call yesterday with an executive from a big company, and giving him the background, and he interrupts me. He's like, wait, I've heard your voice before. And so we used to do a bunch of podcast advertising on the Recode, Decode podcast and Ad Exchanger. And it was like this kind of infamous moment, albeit like very kind of like short-lived. So I can imagine if like that recognizability that I had with somebody that I was like, wow, this is like the fact that I'm talking to this guy, this is kind of a big deal, and he knew who I was. You guys are doing it just on a much bigger scale.
And can I say quick, like, what's so amazing is we'll do these episodes about, like, I don't know, some big business event, right? Like a big IPO or whatever it is. The ones that consistently do the best are, like, our recap from Coachella. Yeah. And our moments, Dee ran a marathon recently. And it's the moments that are more personal that I feel like people really grab to more. And the other thing I wanted to add to Dee's is I think the internet and social media and kind of the getting rid of the barrier to entry and all of these different kind of segments you have to fit into has been really chaotic and hectic. But it's also been great in the sense of, with a podcast, there might be, you know, there's a bunch of comedians that have really famous podcasts. They probably would have never got picked up for TV shows or for, you know, whatever, made it through kind of that process you have to go through. But because they're able to do whatever they want on their own time, however they want, it's allowed them to become stars that nobody would have ever co-signed, and now they don't need it. And I think a lot of people are finding real, like, diamonds in the rough because of podcasting, because you can do whatever you want.
Yeah, it seems like it kind of continues to map back to that authenticity theme. So how do you, like, you guys are running multiple businesses and clothing lines, and you're creating all this content. Like, it's gotta be exhausting. Right. Yeah. Like, how do you find the time to do it? How do you balance your schedule? How do you think about kind of the interconnection and the prioritization across the different things?
I want to say quickly, because you kept saying authenticity. With the podcast stuff, a lot of it goes back to authenticity because we are doing what's true to us on the content front, right? Yeah. We are truly just being ourselves. And we just kind of go up and talk about a couple of the key topics of the day for a group chat. And we sit and just joke and have fun and do it. So it is very difficult prioritizing everything and trying to run businesses and stuff, but I do think that the more authentic you can be, the easier it is to do content and podcasts and stuff like that.
Yeah, and the podcast is basically what we were doing in the office anyways. We just put three microphones.
Right.
So the content is as authentic as it gets. We actually share our opinions. We argue with each other. People are probably sitting in their car screaming at us like, no, Anand's an idiot, or Dee's an idiot, or whatever. And I think that's the kind of magic of what the podcast has become.
Yeah, and I think managing it is really a function of, this is now, like, we don't obviously have advertisers, and that's by choice, because we really want to keep it as pure as we can right now. But we're not afraid of advertising.
if anyone wants to write a check.
but the reality is, it's actually been a huge tool to market our brands now.
Yeah.
And so it has to become, it's become a priority. Like, our subscription business acquired the most amount of members in a 3-day period this last Black Friday. And I got thousands of DMs from people saying, I signed up because of you.
Yeah.
Because I'm connected to you. So yes, it's very hard to manage time to do it, but it's now a priority, and if you make this a priority, the only way your content will grow is, and Drama's the one that really taught me this, is you have to be disciplined and treat it like a schedule. So we have to put out 3 podcasts a week at the exact same time. If we don't, like, we all went to Coachella, and we didn't put out a Monday episode because we were just tired.
Yeah.
And so I wake up in the morning like, where the hell is the goddamn podcast? Because people rely on us on their drive into work or their gym workout. So we realize how important we've become to people.
Right.
Yeah, and also say, like, I've been working with Dee for 12 years now, 13 years, and Dee's been in the business 17, us with Drama 10, and the podcast kind of reinvigorated, at least for me personally, like showing up at the office, because it becomes monotonous.
Yeah.
Showing up at the office, doing the same thing for 12 straight years, 13 straight years, this now kind of gave a new life, like excitement, like, oh, we're doing something new, doing something that's really fun for us to do 3 times a week, so.
Right. And do you think it's like part of the natural evolution or maturation of these types of things, where the first couple big podcasts covered kind of a wide range, and then it's like you have like very specific content-related podcasts. It's like the whole kind of shift from like influencer to micro-influencer. Is it just like the timing is now?
Yeah, and I think we're still so early. Like even discovery of podcasts is impossible today. It's so hard right now because it hasn't been till recently a priority for the two platforms that really, you know, distribute the podcast. And once discovery becomes easy, and if you only like Indian gamers, and there'll be a podcast for you.
Yeah.
Like, there will be an Indian gamer.
It's a niche product.
I know, but I'm just saying, YouTube has that. Like, if you want to only follow people of a certain type or look that do makeup, you can find that on YouTube.
Yep.
And that'll happen for podcasts.
One other thing, too, that I think is like a reason why literally everyone here, I think everyone should start a podcast, especially right now before it gets ultra crowded. The part that happened with my other show, Short Story Long, where I interview entrepreneurs and stuff, is I didn't expect, simply by allocating an hour every week that I need to sit and talk to somebody that I'm interested in, has gained me so much other knowledge and cool relationships and other information that I didn't have before. So I think that's one thing to take into consideration is, if there's a path that you're interested in that you're thinking maybe I should start a podcast about, that's also gonna discipline you to sit down once a week or however often you do it and have those conversations. And you're gonna build this whole other, like Anand said, like it's more fun to go to the office now. I feel like our relationship is even better now because we're, we're making time 3 days a week to sit and talk crap to each other. You know what I mean? There's a lot of other benefits that come from that.
Completely. And so, one thing I love about D is that, like, he's obviously, you're not scared to speak your mind. I think, like, I forget when we were having a conversation, but you were like, you know what? Fuck data. Data doesn't matter. All right, cool. Like, I love like the contrarian view, like the other side of the argument. And then you gave your point on like the impact that you can make by working with celebrity and like a lot of the success that you guys have seen where you have these like really recognizable brand ambassadors and how like for your guys' business that's completely moved the needle and maybe it's not quite like fuck data, maybe it's like a complementary type strategy. But I guess like talk to the audience about the impact that just connecting with your audience via celebrities and athletes and kind of well-known personalities and the impact that that's had.
I think the key to it for celebrities is you actually have to have a relationship with them and they have to have a relationship with your brand that's organic. So like in the case of Chris Paul was a huge fan of 5'4". And we became close friends because of it. And then 5 years later, we worked with him. Mark Wahlberg is obsessed with our brand, like literally hits me up every single week for clothes. And that's, but we're friends. So if we ever did something together, it's like a real relationship. And I think often people just say, I want The Rock. He's the biggest star in the world. Let's just pay him $5, $10 million to Instagram and do a video or do a TV commercial. The customer knows that The Rock and brand X have no real relationship. And that's the real thing. Even with Young and Reckless, Post Malone was one of our brand ambassadors. Post Malone slept on our couch at Coachella before he was a big star. And that relationship, so when Post is on the rise, he's wearing Young and Reckless.
Yeah.
And so that's the difference that I don't think people put the effort in. Like, I always wondered how big companies handle celebrities. They're just sitting in a room and saying, we need The Rock.
Yeah.
And then they're surprised that it doesn't work.
Right.
And I think you actually have to go out there. They need to understand what kind of company you are. Why? Like now when we have a very good relationship with the quarterback of the Cleveland Browns, Baker Mayfield, and he's been wearing the brand for the last year and a half, 2 years, and now we're talking about working together. But that only happened because we were friends and there was a real relationship. And Drama's friends with every hot rapper at any moment, mm-hmm. and that's how... You know,
and let me say this too. Like, obviously, we're in LA. We have a different, like, you know, we've spent a lot of time getting access and building relationships with these people. So if you don't, and you're going to just pay, and I know that influencers and celebrities are really enticing, and it seems sometimes like kind of the magic bullet, but all that they are is a megaphone for whatever your brand is and whatever you're saying. But if they're fans and their followers don't line up with who you want yours to be and the messages don't align, it's completely pointless. And we've also wasted money by thinking, oh, this is someone who's well-dressed. Let's just pay them $100,000 and we're gonna sell so many units. It's gonna be insane. And it does not work like that. You might as well be speaking another language out of that megaphone. So if you get it right, it's perfect and you will see gaining customers and this magic sort of happen. But man, if you get it wrong, it is just completely worthless. So if you can't build the relationship and do it that way, just make sure that you know who their audience is and you are very aligned and you're adding some true value to their audience and them to yours.
Yeah, I think that that's like, I think that's what people in LA probably understand better than people probably in any other city.
Yeah.
I'm super, super bullish on LA tech. Some of our biggest and best customers are headquartered out there. Like, what do you think some of the other cities like New York and San Francisco can learn from the LA tech ecosystem?
I think the biggest opportunity is actually LA people, I feel, listen to their customer better and actually know them. And I think often a lot of businesses, and this is mainly in consumer, that you, like, I don't think a survey is good enough. Like, you have to actually go talk to them. And I think we do, as a brand, a really, really good job. I mean, like, we're doing a meetup tonight. We, you know, we do meetups in LA. We have run clubs. And, like, we, I think we spend a lot of one-on-one time and interaction with our customer. And you start learning about them. And then you can shift your narrative based on what you're learning from your customer. And I think LA people just understand. There's something. The reality is I think LA has a pulse on cool.
Yeah.
And like someone made a comment that like, if you took LA and the celebrity star power of LA, it's most of the consumer influence on earth.
Yeah.
I mean, one family in Calabasas has most of it. Yeah. And so I think like, if you think about it from that perspective, it's so important to understand why those people, why is Kylie Jenner the most important thing in women's consumption.
Yeah, I would say more than ever in history, LA is having a real moment right now. Like it's where all the influencers want to live, it's where all the celebrities are, all that. Like, and if in any way you need to tap into that world or see what's going on in pop culture or any of that stuff, it is undeniably right now the place to be. And also I think for all the tech companies moving there, it's just a cool city. Like it's just better than San Francisco. It's just a fun place to live, man. And I think that you get kind of both. I think tech has always been, in my opinion, one of the biggest problems is it's been very removed from pop culture.
Yep.
So they kind of do their own thing up here and hope that people just adopt it. Where if you can really patch into that world and what kids are using and all these influencers are using, it's huge. And you get to live in LA?
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'll also add, venture capital firms just don't respect companies in LA as much as companies in San Francisco.
Right.
So companies were forced to operate with less capital, be more efficient. So Fashion Nova, perfect example. Yeah. Self-funded and do over $1 billion in revenue. Mm-hmm. FabFitFun, barely raised any capital before this big, massive raise, and they were doing over $300 million in revenue. So I think companies in LA were just forced to hustle harder than companies in other cities where capital is just more readily available.
Yeah, and so I think that's a kind of great segue into the final question. I guess give everybody the lay of the land on how Queensbridge came together, how we've thought about investing in companies, what's been exciting, what are maybe some of the opportunities that we looked at and maybe missed, unfortunately, but.
Yeah, sure. So Queensbridge came about through our close friend, Anthony Saleh, who manages Nas the Rapper. And we were all investing in tech personally and individually since 2008. And we realized, hey, if we all come together, I think we can just have a lot more access and let's go raise some money. So we raised a fund. And I would think the biggest thing that we were able to provide, even though our check size wasn't very big, was that we're actually ready to help and be hands-on. So perfect example, when Lyft was having trouble in New York City years ago, Nas called the mayor. Like, how many, like, 250K check sizes will put that kind of effort? So, you know, we have some great exits. We have a fantastic portfolio that'll do great. So, you know, it's very exciting. We got to meet unbelievable entrepreneurs. So, you know, it's just been a lot of fun.
Cool. Just lastly, before we wrap, just tell everybody where they can find Group Chat and all the other stuff you guys are working on.
Yeah, so Group Chat and Short Story Long Dramas podcast is on iTunes, Spotify, all those great places. And if you don't want to listen to the entire podcast, we put little clips of topics on Instagram under Group Chat Pod. And if you're free tonight before the party, we're going to do a little meetup at the Ainsworth in East Village. It's fascinating who listens to our podcast. Like CEOs of literally the biggest companies on earth have listened to our podcast, and we've built relationships through them, through the podcast with that. So if you guys are up for it, please join us.
Cool. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks for doing this.